Future Talk with Omri Al Saleh and Hani Balkis on Pulse 95.
Good afternoon. Welcome back to Pulse 95. It is me, Hani Balkis, with Omri Al Saleh, bringing you everything you need to know about what's happening in the tech world and in outer space. But today we have a lot to talk about and a lot of exciting topics to discuss. We're talking about how UAE residents are warned against spreading rumors through any social media platforms.
Yes, indeed. We all know how easy it is for us to just forward anything we get on WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram, whatever.
Just like the rumors now, Omnia.
About FaceTime. I'm honestly shocked because I came into the studio and I found out from Hani that FaceTime, once upon a time, a few hours ago, was actually available in the UAE.
It's now, you can now download it on your phone and it will be, the app will be on your phone. But so far, there's only a couple of calls that go through. But who knows?
You know what? Let's try it out in the break. I think you do have FaceTime though, because your phone...
I've had FaceTime.
Yeah, because your phone is not... You didn't buy it from here, I'm guessing. Yes. But around the world, Google Meet is also making big moves when it comes to calling and video chat platforms, because they're adding new Zoom bombing protections for online classes. Now, we all know that Zoom and Google Meet and Microsoft Teams, they have been the lifeline for students and teachers to make sure that education is still carrying out like it typically would in a normal classroom. But can these features actually provide an extra layer of safety for all those teachers and students? We're going to be telling you all about it in just a few moments.
Speaking about layers, Omnia, soon we will go through the ozones into the atmosphere and go all the way to space, because the UAE Hope Probe mission is set to launch tonight.
It is not set to launch tonight.
Not tonight?
It got delayed again because of the weather conditions. But it is going to be launching next week.
My heart is broken.
Is it broken?
I thought before...
You thought we were celebrating on Future Talk. We are. It's soon enough. It's going to be... So it was first postponed to Friday.
I read it before I slept.
No, it was actually postponed a few days ago to Friday. Then there were the weather conditions are still unstable in Japan. So it's actually scheduled for any day between the 20th of July and the 22nd.
All right, my excitement has now died down.
Just a few days. We have more time to
Can't wait.
Excited. But this is exactly why we're going to be speaking to the advisor to the Director General on Strategic Projects at the UAE Space Agency, Mr. Talal Al-Kaissi, who's going to be telling us all about the preparations for the launch of the Hope Probe Mars mission, the reasons for the liftoff delay, and how long this mission is going to be. Such an exciting episode, and we want to take your questions. So if you have any questions about the UAE Hope Probe Mars mission, make sure you send them in at 4215 Duar Ittisalat or slide into our DMs at Pulse 95 Radio.
I'm upset, Omnia.
You're still upset.
I'm in shock. I just wrote on Google when it's been delayed to the 20th and 22nd.
Yeah.
And I'm surprised I didn't read the news. I'm in shock because the last thing
you're
I knew.
You're still sad.
Yeah, because what I thought was, I thought it was tonight, and I was excited.
Yeah,
and
I know.
I was telling my friends, and they were like, "Oh, you sure, honey?" I'm like, "Yeah, man. What are you talking about?" No one told me.
No one gave you a heads up.
No one gave me a heads up.
It's my bad. Next time, I'll make sure to inform you about the Hope Probe Mars mission. But it is definitely an exciting episode that we want you to join us with as well. So if you want to see the behind the scenes that are happening in the Pulse 95 studio, go ahead and head on to our YouTube channel at Pulse 95 Radio and get to see Hani's disappointment with the news.
The UAE Space Agency actually just announced it on the 16th.
Yes.
Yeah, which was at 11 a.m.
They announced the official date. So it was canceled, but then no date was given since this is the second time it gets canceled.
Shame on me.
Oh, no, don't worry. So if you want to find out about all these news and more, make sure you stay tuned right here on Future Talk, only on Pulse 95.
Daily digital news. Bits and bytes connect our world.
Your quick roundup of everything that is happening in the tech world, in the UAE, and around the world. Now, one big trend happening, especially with mothers in the UAE and in different parts around the world, is how any news that they see on social media becomes completely true, completely valid.
Factual.
It becomes factual. They go ahead and they forward it to everyone they know. And it's becoming what we call Facebook news, because it's not always trustworthy. But now UAE residents are being warned against spreading rumors with a hefty fine if we go ahead and do so. The fine can actually be being jailed for up to 1 year. And the reason behind that is because misinformation and fake news can cause a lot more damage than we think.
Yes, indeed. Now, people who forward false information and rumors on WhatsApp or any other social media platform can face imprisonment for at least a year. Now, this is very important, Omnia, because right now, before these laws have been implemented, there have been talk and the UAE media has been telling you guys that, listen, don't spread information and you might get fined and you might get imprisoned and there will be consequences.
Absolutely.
But now, because of the pandemic we're in, it's become more important to tell everyone that, listen, if there is no official source, if you don't have any facts, you need to fact check every type of information that's being forwarded to you on WhatsApp. Because, for example, Omnia, let's say that someone writes a very nice message and it looks nice and it looks very
professional, well-written.
And someone says, hey, guess what? N95 masks don't protect you anymore. Go back to surgical masks, right? And oh, everyone's like, oh my God, this looks so professional. And they start sending it out to each other. Then all of a sudden, we have people not wearing N95 masks because they think that this was a actual post by someone who knows what they're talking about. Now, Omnia, there was actually a social experiment that happened in the U.S. They got a picture, right? They took a very professional picture, Omnia. They made it look like a media office did it. And they just put out a lot of gibberish, right? They're saying something about how the world is going to turn green or something like that, right? Mm-hmm. And they made it very, it looks super professional. Mm-hmm. And they put it on Facebook, Omnia. In under 4 hours, it got 120,000 shares.
Oh, wow.
In under 4 hours. And that it was a social experiment. And it just went to show that people, they don't fact check. If they see something that looks professional, they will repost it and share it and tell everyone about it.
Absolutely. But we are currently living in an age where you can't always trust what you see. And especially, as you mentioned, during the pandemic, a lot of messages were actually being circulated between public or amongst the public on social media platforms about false information. We had people mention that there's going to be a full lockdown on the entire UAE at some point, and that was not coming from a legitimate source. And this is exactly why we constantly have to make sure that whatever news we're getting, it is coming from an official source.
And you don't know how strong, no one knows how strong the power social media contains.
Oh, it is very strong.
Now, Omnia, if I tell you, right, that unofficially, obviously, this didn't happen, that the whole UAE is going on lockdown in tomorrow or in 2 days, right? You're going to tell one person, another person is going to say, and everyone's going to panic. Everyone's going to go out, and then they're going to go to the jam'iyya or the supermarket or whatever, and start buying things in bulk.
Absolutely.
And thus, not leaving things for people who actually do need it, just as, like you. So this goes to show that if you don't know what source of information your source of information is coming from, don't spread it.
Absolutely. And we're lucky right here in the UAE because we are blessed with such
we have so many media outlets.
Exactly. And official news outlets that we can go ahead and get our trusted information from. And we are free to share trusted information with our loved ones.
For example, Sharjah Police, when the lockdown went, they didn't put it on they put it on social media. But to make it more official, they sent you an SOS message.
Yes.
They sent you that alert to let you know, the Amber alert to let you know that, listen, this is official, you cannot go out after 10 p.m.
Absolutely.
So you always need to know where you're getting your information and how factual that information is. Even Omnia, even some news websites, they do spread fake information because the journalists themselves, they don't fact check it.
True. So, and this is why you have to also measure where you're getting your news from.
Just as us, because thankfully, just like you said, we have so many media outlets in the UAE that are government, and we should get only our information. Omni and I have talked about this time and time again on the show. Our information should be from government Instagrams, Twitter accounts, government websites. Only take information that the government has given to us.
Absolutely. And we are responsible for the messages that we go ahead and forward to others. You know, you can't take cover and say that you didn't intend to circulate false information because you're responsible on what text messages you are sending out there. So make sure that whenever you're forwarding news to your loved ones, to your family members, that you are ensuring that this news is coming from a trusted source. But let's talk a little bit about video chat platforms.
Talk of the day, actually, right now.
It has been talk of the day.
Everyone is talking about how it's a rumor, right? But the rumor is true to an extent.
That FaceTime is available in the UAE.
FaceTime is available in the UAE if you update to 13.6. But it's there. The app is there, but you cannot actually
make
use it
calls.
Yet. You can't make any calls. But
true.
What is Google doing, Omnia?
Google is actually trying to kind of take a step up when it comes to competing with Zoom and Microsoft Teams, because they're actually turning on new security features in their Google Meet video chat service. So for all of its education subscribers, they're going to ensure their safety, because as we all know, Zoom bombing attacks have been on the rise ever since students started learning from home and learning from a distance. But now an anonymous user is anyone not signed into a Google account, and they will not be allowed into any phone call. So this is going to be taking effect over the next 15 days. So any anonymous user will not be able to join any meetings that are organized by an education account. So this doesn't go for all accounts, but rather only accounts that have been under the education umbrella.
You know what I find super funny, Omnia?
What?
Is that Google Meet, Google is doing this. Google does not own Zoom, but they're using the terminology Zoom bombing, which just goes to show...
To throw shade at Zoom, too.
Not only throw shade on you, it just shows you the power Zoom has obtained in the past couple of months, and how they are now have their own brand and own
terminology
slogan.
Their own
terminology. So now this just goes to show, I personally believe, that no one right now can compete with Zoom. I believe not Google, not Microsoft. No one can compete with Zoom because Zoom bombing is a thing now. It's something that even Google themselves have been using, and it's just making the brand Zoom bigger and bigger.
True, and especially because Zoom definitely did introduce a lot of new security features and privacy improvements over the past month, since they did promise the public with a 90-day security promise or privacy promise, where they're basically going to work on advancing their privacy restrictions to make sure that no one gets or becomes a victim of Zoom bombing. Let us know, what is your favorite video chat platform that you have been using to connect with your family and loved ones over the past few months? Is it Zoom? Is it Microsoft Teams?
Is it TuTalk? We haven't heard about TuTalk in a while.
Yeah, I agree. But I feel like TuTalk has definitely faced a lot of issues over the past few months
It has faced, but I mean, it's the hype has went down by a lot. I mean, TuTalk used to be the talk of our show as well. But I mean, I personally believe that Zoom will hold that position for a while as the top, as a lot of government in the U.S., around the world, everyone is using Zoom. Government entities are using Zoom.
Actually,
to connect with one another.
Actually, a lot of them have actually stopped using Zoom. They've gone for Microsoft Teams because they felt like it's safer.
But I've been seeing in the U.S. something now. Yeah. Schools are going to reopen in the U.S.
Yeah.
And ironically enough, in the U.S., the board, the school board, actually had a meeting through Zoom.
Oh, God.
And what?
After New York banned Zoom in their schools?
But what's funny, not the schools, the boards.
Yeah.
But you know what's funny, Omnia?
What?
And I feel ironic. So to me, the U.S. is a game show right now, right? So they have a meeting through Zoom because it's unsafe to meet. What is the meeting about?
To reopen
schools.
Oh, God.
So they're going to send thousands of students back to school, but they know it's not safe, so they're going to have a Zoom meeting to talk about it. What I mean, the U.S. is a funny country.
The controversy is definitely ongoing. But coming up on Future Talk, we're gonna be having a very interesting conversation all about the Hope Probe Mars mission. It is an event that we are all very excited about, and we're all on the edge of our seats.
It's been delayed quite a bit, but you know what the saying says.
Exactly. There is good in every delay. But speaking to us will be the advisor to the Director General on Strategic Projects at the UAE Space Agency, Mr. Talal Al-Kaissi. If you have any questions, make sure you send them in at 4215 Du'ur Ittisalat, or slide into our DMs at Pulse95 Radio. Keep Pulse95 locked. We'll be right back.
Future Talk with Omnia Al-Saleh and Hani Balkis on Pulse95.
Although humans have yet to step foot on Mars, the road to the red planet has never been busier. The UAE is very close to achieving yet another historic feat as it prepares to launch its Hope spacecraft for a mission to Mars next week, sometime between July 20th and July 22. And this is going to be the Arab world's first interplanetary mission that has been developed by a team of 200 Emirati engineers. They have worked for millions and millions of hours, about 5.5 million hours, to build the very first weather satellite to orbit Mars. And joining us today is the advisor to the Director General on Strategic Projects at the UAE Space Agency, Mr. Talal Al-Kaissi. Mr. Talal, thank you so much for joining us today.
My pleasure. Thank you, Omnia.
Welcome to the show. It's great to have you on the show. I mean, talking about the Hope Probe is something that, I mean, it seems surreal to us, but now hopefully it will come to reality.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, it's a mixture of different nerves I don't think I've ever felt before. And this is me, someone who really had the bare minimum to do with actually building the spacecraft. I work in the non-engineering part of the space agency, to be honest. So I can't imagine what my colleagues that are engineers at both the Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center and the UAE Space Agency, that the types of emotions they're going through seeing that thing. Sitting on top of a rocket waiting for the weather to get better so it can launch.
As someone who has nothing to do, I literally have nothing to do with it. I woke up this morning and I was excited because I initially thought that tonight was the launch at Friday, basically after 12 a.m., so which is Friday, was the launch. But again, I remembered that it was July 20th to the 22nd, around that time.
Yeah, so this morning, you know, we did another check and had a meeting in Tangashima with the launch provider Mitsubishi Heavy and the Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center and the UAE Space Agency. And, you know, the upper winds and the weather in Japan hasn't been great in these last few days. So it looks like the next, optimal window is going to take place sometime between the 20th and 22nd, as you mentioned. So we're hoping to have a definitive date and time soon.
We're definitely very excited. I feel like the whole world is excited for the launch of the HOPE probe, not just the UAE and not just the Middle East. But can you share with us where the probe is right now and walk us through the preparations that are currently taking place ahead of the launch?
Yeah, so the probe's at the launch site, obviously, and it goes through a variety of different system checks every once in a while to ensure that things are still in optimal working condition. Mm-hmm. Particularly if it ends up going to the pad, there's going to be a sequence pre-launch that ensures that everything is working as it should. And then obviously the launch vehicle gets loaded with their appropriate fuel and then it launches. So, you know, I think right now it's a matter of our team is all there, everyone's prepared, everyone's ready, and everyone was also expecting that there might be something like this that happens. This is completely not unexpected in the space world. I think weather, it's great that it's a weather issue, not a technical issue with the launch vehicle, like in some other cases when delays take place. And the other good thing is, you have to remember, I mean, we are at the very beginning of the launch window, and we had targeted the very beginning because of how amazing our team was in completing things ahead of schedule. And even through a pandemic, being able to logistically overcome the challenges that presented and brought getting it to the launch pad in time with a team of Emiratis that were there from, I think, April. And so we have the luxury of a whole launch window to take our time and ensure it's done right, because you want to ensure that you take no unnecessary risks in this type of a situation.
So I have a question going back to the launch pad. So the rocket is put every time you guys want to put a check back on the launch pad, and then you guys remove it from the launch pad?
Yeah, I mean, not every single time, because it just depends on how long before the weather update comes in, right? So you could have it on the launch pad and then the weather ends up not being as favorable as it should be, and then you have to take it back off. Or you figure out that the weather is not going to be optimal way in advance and you just never put it on the launch pad in the first place, right? So it just depends on the situation.
Absolutely. And let's talk a little bit about the journey of the probe, because from what I heard, that once the HOPE probe actually enters the Martian orbit, the whole operation is actually going to be completely 100% autonomous. So can you walk us through the journey of the probe the minute it launches from the Tanegashima Island up until it reaches Mars?
Yeah. So, I mean, the probe is obviously it's gonna launch, and then hopefully a few minutes later it'll reach orbit. And then once it's in orbit, it's going to deploy its solar panels, try to get to the right orientation to be able to capture the energy from the sunlight and power the systems. And then at some point, about an hour or so after launch, we should receive the first signal at the ground station at the Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center. Mm-hmm. And after that point, that would be a great milestone in the mission post-launch that shows us that spacecraft is healthy and in its correct orbit. And then over the next few days, it'll correct its orbit to a point where it would then be able to do the trans-Martian injection, basically, to go into a cruise for about a seven-month period. I mean, it's going to travel for quite some time, right?
Absolutely.
Up until February of 2021 is when we anticipate it'll arrive in the Martian orbit. And then it's going to go through, moving from the capture orbit in Mars to the science orbit about a month or two later, I think, and then start its science mission and operations for the following 3 years.
Do you guys plan on bringing the probe back, or is it going to stay on Mars?
No, in this case, it's going to stay there. It's going to stay around Mars orbiting, and hopefully we'll have the main science operations and some extended mission time beyond that.
Maybe we can go and retrieve it later.
I feel like, is it coming back though? And when should we expect it to be back to Earth?
No, it won't come back to
At
Earth.
All.
So it'll continue to be orbiting Mars.
Okay.
And continue its science mission for the duration and the lifetime of the spacecraft.
So,
some point in the very distant future, hopefully not too soon, it'll run out of its fuel and its ability to send back information. But I think it's going to be hopefully longer than the mission objective has stated today, which is a 3-year science operation.
And apart from our Earth, Mars is typically considered the most explored planet in our solar system. So a lot of people might be wondering, why is it that Mars we're planning to study, and how similar is it to the atmosphere on planet Earth?
Yeah, you know, I think it's important to note that, with Mars, it's in what they call the Goldilocks zone, like Earth, which means basically that liquid water can exist. And the way we know life persists is because of the ability for liquid water to persist. And so the fact that Mars, once upon a time, ancient Mars, if you look at pictures of ancient Mars, it looked very much similar to Earth. It's just a little bit smaller in terms of its mass, but it had liquid water, it had oceans, it had rivers. And you can tell from that, from the geology there, that that's the situation, and something happened. So we're trying to study and understand what happened to be able to apply that knowledge to what we know here on Earth in terms of how we're inducing an impact to climate. So potentially what we should do differently with respect to trying to mitigate climate change that could induce a similar fate. So that's interesting knowledge. But then also, if humans were ever to settle any other place in the solar system, Mars is the most opportune because of the fact that it can have liquid water, and it did once upon a time. So you look at ways that what we understand from here can lead us in that path.
Absolutely. And we're definitely going to be coming back to learn more about the significance of the mission's name and the aim behind this mission, whether it was on an outer space or even right here on Earth, because it's definitely going to have a huge impact on all the Emirati youth and the Arab world in general.
And the world in general. I mean, going to Mars is something that you wouldn't expect 20 years ago. So,
absolutely.
I mean, we're excited to see what the mission has in store for us.
If you have any questions for Mr. Talal Al-Kaissi, make sure you send them in at 4215 Duar Tisalat or slide into our DMs at Pulse 95 Radio. Keep Pulse 95 locked. We'll be right back.
10
9
8
7
6
5
4
3
2
1
And we're off for liftoff.
We are literally off for liftoff. And the reason why we are actually playing the countdown in Arabic is because this is the first time the countdown to Mars is actually going to be done in Arabic. Can you imagine?
That's crazy. I mean, it's amazing. And thinking about it, I mean, it kind of gives me a little bit of chills and goosebumps when that time comes to watch it live and you're hearing 10, 9, Thamania, 7, 6, 5, and then off to liftoff.
We've heard it in English, we've heard it in Russian, but never have we heard it done in Arabic. And this is because this is going to be the Arab world's first interplanetary mission that has been developed by a team of 200 Emirati engineers. They have worked amidst the coronavirus pandemic when all of
day
us were
in
on
and
lockdown.
Day night. Yeah, they've worked and they've tried their best, but unfortunately, there has been a couple of delays. But hopefully, within next week, we will see the Hope probe go into space. And to tell us more about it, we have Mr. Talal Al-Kaissi, who is the advisor to the Director General on Strategic Projects at the UAE Space Agency.
Absolutely. If you have any questions for Mr. Talal, make sure you send them in at 4215 Duar Ittisalat or slide into our DMs at Pulse 95 Radio. Mr. Talal, it's such an honor to have you with us on the show.
Thank you so much,
Amir. We all are definitely excited about the name of the mission. So the name of the mission is HOPE. It's called the HOPE probe. And a lot of us have definitely questioned the reason behind the naming of the probe. So can you tell us a little bit about the significance of it?
Yeah, I mean, it's very significant. Obviously, what we're trying to do is inspire hope, especially regionally here. I think. And at a time like this in particular, I think it's not just regionally, globally, we all can use a little bit more hope with everything that the world's going through. But if you think about it, it's a matter of trying to have a positive spillover effect and a positive narrative emanate from this part of the world, which is not really what we've seen happen traditionally. And so I think Part of what we're trying to do is ensure that there's an outlet for the youth that are interested in STEM education and don't think that they can particularly pursue anything career-wise in it. We want to give them an option, and I think this is something that we are hoping resonates well across the region, not just in the UAE.
Mm-hmm. A lot of us are wondering about the aim behind this mission. So as we all know, there are definitely scientific aims and objectives behind going to Mars with the Hope probe, as well as a bigger picture and a governmental objective behind it. So can you tell us a little bit about both and what type of studies will be conducted for us to learn more about the Martian atmosphere?
Yeah, sure. I think it's probably prudent to take a step back and also maybe give a quick scene setter as to how it came about. And when, in the time that this was announced, when the UAE Space Agency was established in 2014, and this mission was announced at that time, there was really, I mean, typically how these things work with big missions for deep space, you start by forming and defining the science questions that need to be answered, and then looking at how you would figure out the benefits to society to justify the costs. In this case, I think that traditional logic was quite inverted to with the main objective being to fundamentally redirect the nation's trajectory. So this is kind of a mission for national development before it's a mission for science. And what's also amazing to note is the fact that this mission's journey up until the launch date, rather than just from launch date until it completes its science objectives. When we started, there was no previous domestic space exploration experience or planetary science capacity, or even the requisite infrastructure required for something like this was not non-existent. And the deadline that we were tasked with was approximately half of the time used by other comparable missions. So it's amazing to see how it was able to meet all the objectives of the government, which were more to find ways to inspire STEM education and train UAE into engineers and build human capital. So that's kind of the main objective, and you can say by all intents and purposes it's mission accomplished by virtue of it being on the launch pad.
Absolutely. I mean, before it even launches, it's been an accomplishment.
Now we are going to Mars to learn about Mars, but what can we learn from Earth, more about Earth, from our mission to Mars?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think it's important to note that because of the similarities in composition, especially this ancient Mars and how Earth is, it's going to be a matter of trying to understand better why Mars is losing its upper atmosphere in particular. And this probe is going to be the first one that kind of draws a complete and comprehensive picture of the Martian climate. And why it's losing its atmosphere to space. It's going to try to track the behavior and the escape of hydrogen and oxygen, and then also try to investigate the correlation between the lower and the upper levels of the Martian atmosphere. So this is really the first truly global picture of the atmosphere between days and seasons. This is not something that any other mission prior to it has done in the past. So it'll add a lot of knowledge to observe the weather as well, and dust storms and other things with respect to its objective.
Absolutely, and especially because all the information that's going to be collected by the Hope probe will be open for researchers to use free of cost. So it's definitely a great accomplishment to add to the UAE's history as well. Going back to the studies that are going to be conducted on the surface of Mars, there are three major studies. Could you please tell us more about them?
Yeah, so nothing's going to happen on the surface. I mean, we might image the surface, but this is all going to happen in an orbit. So the interesting thing here, since it's not a lander, it's an orbiter, I think what we're looking at is, first of all, it's going to have this very unique, innovative orbit trajectory that no other mission has ever used, which is going to allow it to have this kind of egg-shaped orbit, which will allow the spacecraft with its sensors, the three sensors that you mentioned, to pass through the upper and the mid and the lower atmospheres. And what are those sensors and what are they going to give us? So you have the Emirates Exploration Imager, which is like a camera that will capture like high resolution images of Mars and measure water ice in the ozone and lower atmosphere through the UV bands. The second is an infrared spectrometer, and this is going to measure the global distribution of dust, clouds, water vapor in the Martian lower atmosphere. And then the third is the ultraviolet spectrometer, which is going to measure oxygen, carbon monoxide, and this is mostly in the thermosphere, and the variability of hydrogen and oxygen in the upper atmosphere. So these are the questions that we're hoping to answer.
Hopefully. We're definitely going to be getting a lot of answers about the surface of Mars and the surface of Earth. Coming up on Future Talk, we're going to be telling you all about the UAE's plan to build a habitable settlement on Mars by 2117, and how will the Hope Probe Mars mission actually contribute to that, as well as the bigger picture of the space race that is happening right now all around the world, and how the UAE will be putting its mark on that space race as well. So make sure you stay tuned right here on Future Talk. Lots and lots is coming up. So keep Pulse 95 locked, and we'll be right back.
10
9
8
7
6
5
4
3
2
1
This is the moment that we are all waiting for right here in the UAE. There has been some delays for the UAE Hope Probe Mars mission, but this only means that we have more time to be excited for it. Next week, July 20th, any day between the July 20th and July 22, hopefully. It is called the Hope Probe, so we're having a lot of hope for it. We will be witnessing one of the biggest events in history, especially coming from the UAE, and it's honestly a celebration for the Arab world as well. It's the first interplanetary mission that has been developed by a team of Emirati engineers right here in the UAE.
Yes, now there has been some delays, but you know what the saying says, كلتا خيرها في أخيرها. So it's every time something is delayed, it might be for a good cause. And we're going to be talking about what does Mars hold for us?
Absolutely. So joining us today is the advisor to the Director General on Strategic Projects at the UAE Space Agency, Mr. Talal Al-Kaissi, who will be joining us today to tell us a little bit more about the UAE's future plans when it comes to hopefully maybe making it our second home. Welcome to the show once again, Talal.
Thank you, Amelia. Thank you.
A lot of us are definitely excited about this question, because even though I love planet Earth, it's always good to feel like there is a second option or a backup plan. So the UAE has plans to build a habitable settlement on Mars by the year 2117. So in your opinion, will the Hope Probe Mars mission contribute to that, and in what ways will it do that?
Absolutely. I think it's important to note that this 100-year plan and vision by the UAE is one to help us make a generational shift in the mindset towards STEM education, and hopefully have projects that are incremental in the lead up to that, that bring us closer to that date, or bring that date closer to us. And I think the Hope Probe, even our human spaceflight program, and other missions that we have, everything is going to give us some more knowledge that would allow us to bring that vision into realization eventually. So hopefully what we learn about the climate on Mars and the properties of the atmosphere is going to help for that eventuality.
Mm-hmm. And there are definitely bigger plans for this mission apart from just in outer space. A lot of us are hopeful that the Hope Probe will actually inspire more or less of an investment ecosystem that's economically sustainable. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, actually, that's an area that I work very closely on at the UAE Space Agency. We're constantly trying to find ways to engage with not just our space stakeholders in the country like Yasat and Thuraya and others, but actually the adjacent industries. So if you think of, for example, the energy industry or municipalities, many technologies that we use today that would be useful and help optimize the efficiency of many of those sectors are enabled by space-based assets and technologies, whether they be satellites or GPS or whatever it might be. Mm-hmm. And then if you think even further down the line with things like, for example, the Mars 2117 settlement, there's no way that you can have a settlement that have to take everything you need with you from Earth. Mm-hmm. You have to have some sort of a self-sustaining habitable settlement, which means that you're going to need to be able to work off the land that's there and mine things. So you can look at the parallels and synergies that some adjacent industries like energy and mining on Earth, especially the ones that we excel in, can have in helping realize that objective and find ways to optimize R&D between the two to even better terrestrial applications that use those technologies.
Mm-hmm. Now, this question has been thrown around a lot over the past couple of years, but why Mars and not the moon?
Yeah, I mean, Mars, because of the properties, as I mentioned, that make it good for potential settlement and habitability. The moon lacks an atmosphere, and then also isn't as conducive to life. Although I would say that there may be a chance that the moon becomes a critical on the critical path to Mars, because what you can do on the moon, it's a lot closer. It's only a 3-day trip. It's easy. You can at least see it from here. And so if you have emergencies and stuff, if you want, and it's cheaper to probably do things on the moon. So if you want to use it as a way to retire risk and test technologies and demonstrate things before doing them on Mars, it might be a good place. And then there's also water ice on the moon as well. It's not just ice on Mars that can be converted into hydrogen and oxygen to make rocket propellant, but on the moon, they say that there are large deposits in permanently shadowed craters of water that can be mined. So it's one of the steps that many countries are gravitating towards in that ultimate objective of
Absolutely. I feel like the opportunities and the possibilities are endless. But let's talk a little bit about the global picture of the space sector. You know, it started out with, especially right here in the UAE, with the journey of Hazza al-Mansouri back in September of 2019. And now we are celebrating, hopefully, the Hope Probe Mars mission. And these two are not just a one-time success that we get to celebrate. I feel like these are more or less developing an industry of space exploration in the UAE. So how do you see this going forward? What do you envision for this future of space exploration right here in the UAE?
Yeah, I think that's correct. Absolutely. I think, I mean, Hazza's mission was not a one-off tourist type of mission. It's the beginning of a sustainable human spaceflight program. You can see through the applications that we had, 4,000 at that time, and now 4,000 in new application with 34% women, which is something we're extremely proud of as well, that we are really serious about continuing the experiments that he had. He had about 16 experiments and then maybe lengthening the duration. So that's one. And living on another planet, you're going to have to live in space and try different things and have these experiments. So that's one aspect. In terms of the future missions that the agency and other space centers in the country would have, there will definitely be a lot of future missions in the lead up to Mars 2117. Mm-hmm. But when you talk about the industry we're trying to develop and the ecosystem we're trying to develop, I think the enabling effect that the UAE Space Agency has through its regulatory and policy setup allows for incentives so that we can have industries and companies come from other places, as well as organic ones get started with entrepreneurs here to feed into that ecosystem.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people are definitely excited on where can they watch the live launch. Mm. So if they don't get a chance to head to the space agency or the Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center, where can they watch it from the comfort of their own home?
Yeah, we have it on the website. If you go to the either the Emirates Mars Mission website, there's a live link, or on the UAE Space Agency or Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center website, you'll find the live link, and there's a countdown clock, typically when you have a definitive time.
So we're waiting. Is it in Arabic or in English?
But yeah.
So hopefully soon, by next week, we will see the Mars mission, the Hope probe go into orbit to Mars. And we're very excited. And hopefully soon, we'll have something new to talk about and we'll know what kind of discoveries the Hope probe has made of Mars.
Correct. Yeah, I think that's extremely important. That's the goal.
Mr. Talal, any last words for anyone tuning in right now who may be interested in learning more about space and maybe getting into the industry? What can they do? What is one to two things that they can work on from today so that maybe one day they will be the next Hazza al-Mansouri? Who knows?
Yeah, you know, an astronaut doesn't necessarily have to be someone with a background in science or engineering. This is the message I try to leave a lot of people with. First of all, it's important that if you're passionate about space, that you look at space as a whole industry, as a sector, rather than just the science and engineering part, which means you need lawyers, you need engineers, you need doctors, you need people from, it's multidisciplinary. So don't think that you have to be a STEM education graduate to be able to be in the space. I'm living proof of that. but in terms of what's to come next, there's a lot of excitement about commercial space. You see what's happening in the US with companies like SpaceX and Blue Origin and
Starlink,
and so it's incredible to see that we're living at a time where I think the convergence of lower cost of access to space through reusability and then the miniaturization of space technologies like the spacecraft satellites itself or the sensors are creating an enabler for new business models that can be built on top of those platforms and become really commercial and really viable economically. So it's not anymore the game of governments with large spending, but really any company can take advantage of of what space has to offer and how it can optimize their particular use case and business.
Absolutely. What an exciting time for us to live in. The countdown is starting, and the countdown is also marking the end of Future Talk. Thank you so much, Mr. Talal, for joining
us
today.
Thank you for your time. It was very interesting talk. I mean, hopefully soon we'll have you back on the show to talk about all the discoveries we made on Mars.
It will be my pleasure. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you so much for everyone for tuning in today, whether you were tuning in from our YouTube channel, pulse95radio.com, or SBA app. Future Talk is coming to an end, but our shows on Pulse 95 will keep you entertained throughout the day. So keep Pulse 95 locked, and we'll see you next time.
Heart of Sharjah. This is Pulse 95.